the effect of these thinning now will be interesting, by the way, landscape. And in particular, the two models you expect to preferentially nucleate brains that decrease the fluxes corresponding to the smallest charges, because those are the cheapest ones to nucleate. So you get a prediction. You predict that we should, if we could look at the manifold and see which fluxes are turned on, we should see the smallest charges between this. And I think that, you know, we'll work in this direction, might eventually really connect up with some prediction. That the thinning out, the vector that you don't get to, or that I suspect, is much less drastic than if I had had a dependence on the original matrix kappa with its many exponentially small parameters. Because then I would get exponentially strong variation between different probabilities, and only with the biggest probability then would be vector in the landscape that can actually be accessed. So that could have thinned it out very considerably. And Joe was briefly talking about that. So I have very little time left, so I will just run through this very quickly. The part three, this is a much less precise part anyway. The question is whether we can replace entropic selection in very specific conditions like structure formation, galaxies have to be able to cool, stars have to form, etc. With something more generic that we have some reason to believe makes sense in that with very different energy theories. And that seems that we just seem to be specific. On the other hand, while we're looking at the global point of view, it seems like we can only say, well, either there are zeros there or not, because if there are any, there will be an infinite number, so it's very, very much not nuanced. Okay. And that's where we can make some progress with the holographic or causal point of view. The volume of interaction is no longer infinite. And so we can introduce a quantitative weighting effect here that mitigates the problem I just mentioned. The idea is that observers require free energy, whatever else they're made of. Presumably you can't have everything completely thermalized and have observers form. You have to be able to increase the entropy. And so why don't we estimate at least the potential complexity of the vacuum by how much it allows the entropy to increase between making the vacuum and thermalization? In other words, we're interested in an entropy difference, something like the free energy divided by the temperature at which you burn it up. Okay. And you expect something like this to at least capture Weinberg's criterion of structure formation. Because, you know, that's the energy, gravitational energy that's collapsing, that we're really burning up. Okay, so what I mean by the entropy difference shown here is the proper environment, entropy in, entropy out. And it turns out that we should test this idea on the one data point we have, our universe. It amazingly well captures things that we usually put in by hand. Because if you ask what is the main contribution to the entropy existence through heating, it comes from stellar burning. Okay, so not only do you need structure formation, you really need very specific things like galaxy formation, which by the way also gives you some non-trivial contributions, and long-lived stars. But it's an amazingly well, amazingly knowledgeable criterion for something so simple. And now you know it at least, it really puts a finger on things that we needed to be here. And so you might hope that it captures what we normally call an anthropic selection, also in other vacuums that are very different. Okay, and that's what I call the anthropic principle, excuse me. And as an application of that, you can ask what happens to the Weinberg bound when everything scans. If you expect that you want to increase the cosmological constant around because they're more accurate like that. But if you do that, you actually decrease the complexity enormously in each of these vacuums. And so depending on how the complexity scales with the cosmological constant, this can even overcompensate for the larger number of vacuums at larger lambda, and push it towards small lambda. Or you might end up with a flat distribution in large lambda. Or at the very least, and I think this is the most realistic case, you still need a cutoff like Weinberg did, but you're not pushed up so hard against it, so you can absorb a bigger discrepancy. I don't think this is right for, you know, drawing strong conclusions from it, other than the fact that I think it's really important to try to estimate this weight factor as a function of the entropy difference, and especially as a function specifically of the cosmological constant, because it predicts where we are in the landscape. And more important for the time being, I think, is that the weight factor does not depend on. Right? It does not depend on these exponentially large factors that are really hard to compute, like the lifetime of the vacuum, especially volume expansion. Those things don't enter at all, other than that you want it to be stable enough to wait until lambda dominates roughly, and you want it to last long enough to make sure curvature doesn't dominate and prevent you from harvesting free energy before the cosmological constant does so anyway. Okay. You still solve the coincidence problem, because all of the entropy increases happening in the era when the cosmological constant is about starting to dominate. That's when the universe is already big and not yet empty. Okay, so here's the summary. All that cutoff allows you to compute probabilities in the thermalization, and well-defined way, you don't run into any of these huge ambiguities and topologies that take a global picture, and you end up with a simple matrix equation that's even fairly easy to solve and allows useful approximations. The anthropic principle is the idea that in step three, where you don't want to make any prior assumptions about what observers need to look like, you simply wait back to an appropriate function of the entropy difference. That's to capture the potential complexity and the chance for observers to form. And at least our universe is working amazingly well, so maybe it really does capture this more generally. You thin out the discretium, there are some vacuums that you don't reach or that are anthropically not preferred, but that's not nearly as much as if you have these hugely varying probabilities from the matrix kappa ij that you need in the global picture. And I think you're more predictive. I mean, the example of, you know, we should find a small charges turned off. I think that's still very primitive, but it's a simple example that shows that it really needs some predictions for our vacuum. Thank you.
I guess that's just a very short time. Are there any questions, sir?
The statement that the component vector V to AOB relies on the regularity condition, but the V in string landscape is essentially replaced by
a regularity condition, you mean?
It relies on the fact that there are more regular infinite solutions that get you from A to B, from V to AOB. But if V is essentially replaced by a singularity, there's no justification for that regularity condition, and it means there are in fact instantons that get you back to AOB. So I wonder what justifies, on the one hand, disregarding the lower initial conditions of the singularity.
If there are instantons, semi-classical instantons that take you from a lambda less than zero solution back up to a lambda greater than zero vacuum, I certainly am not aware of them. I mean, it seems very improbable to me since one of these things doesn't even get anywhere close to an equilibrium.
Well, I'm saying that if that statement relies on there being no regular infinite solution, but which I think is reasonable, that if in reality V is replaced by a singularity,
it's not replaced by a singularity. You're going to see a lot of things that happen, but you end up in a singularity.
Yeah, that's what I mean. But then at that point, there is a finite and improbability back to AOB, because there are.
Well, that's a statement that you're making that I don't agree with, but it doesn't really matter because I'm just presenting a formalism that can deal both with cyclic and terminal landscape. So if you don't think that V is terminal, you can still apply this. And it really doesn't matter as far as the useful doing it. I just wanted to write down what I consider to be the most general case, so that it, you know, that illustrates the working of it. You definitely need to decay on a much shorter time scale than the recurrence time. The probability for nucleating Boltzmann's grain is at about 2 to the minus P over T, and the temperature here is that of the bitter state, so that's simply, the one over T is simply the radius of the bitter state, okay? And you're comparing that to E to the minus R squared, the probability for a Poincaré recurrence, okay? Now, E is going to be much less than R for Boltzmann's grain, presumably, you know, it's not a black hole filling up the whole universe. So this number is very, very small. I mean, like, the depression here is not so serious compared to Poincaré recurrences, and it could still be absolutely enormous compared to the fast decay channels. I see a pretty good reason why the decay time should not have anything to do with this, which is that, you know, in fact, you're only interested in the problem investing with small cosmological constants, and there, the way you get a cosmological constant is actually you get a lot of ingredients, each of which has nothing to do with that scale. That scale is accidental. And so the decay time has something to do with the scale of these various ingredients, and there are hundreds of them. So especially the fastest one is going to be much faster than this. But I think this is a very interesting condition to actually try to check. And then I think we should look more at what the fastest decay channels are, and if they satisfy this condition.
Yes, Uncle Perrin, ready for next.
This is a short talk about the non-fathom. So, I'm going to report on work done in collaboration with Arthur Hilliker and Kilo Capetti and Domenico Ciccolini. The wrong assignment of one model, as we all probably know, is a slice of radius 5 between two four-dimensional planes, or boundaries, and which is interesting for some monologists, because it addresses the hierarchy problem, because it has an interest in maybe fields, and, well, because it has a particular six-dimensional